Welcome to this edition of Authors and Poets featuring Richard Ruelas, Metro columnist for the Arizona Republic. Ruelas discusses Thanks for Tuning In, his biography of local legend Bill Thompson, creator of the Wallace and Ladmo Show.
Hey, thanks. The Republic got no applause. When you said the Republic, people are supposed to spontaneously cheer, wildly. Thank you all for coming out. This is the book, by the way, and I hope some of you have it and have seen it or read it. This is selfish. I mean, I spent some time and work mining this man across from his dining room table for years, but I realize after this is done, this part is selfish, because for me, this is a chance, as a guy who grew up with the show and was a big fan of the show and a big admirer of this man, to let him come to places like this, have him meet people who can let him know, because I try to tell him constantly, but it sounds better coming from different people, how much he meant to us, how much he meant to Arizona, and how lucky we are that this show happened. Even if you grew up on the show and read a lot about the show, there's stuff you don't know, and there's stuff that I didn't know, mainly because he never told anybody. And for several months, he didn't tell me. even as we kept working, as I was asking him about various aspects of his life, little details would come up now and then that would change the direction of a story. Oh, wow, you didn't tell me that great detail. And so I, for a fan of the show, as I hope most of you are, this is a real good insight, and you'll appreciate the show and the man a lot more, I hope, because there's stuff in here that hasn't been told before, and he wasn't about to, because he's one of the most humble men you'll ever meet. And it's my pleasure to bring up for you, and please let him know how much you care. My buddy, my friend, Wallace,
Bill Thompson.
Thank you very much, and thanks for the kind words, Richard. I was not his first choice for a biography. Joe Arpaio and Tex Earnhardt turned him down.
I went alphabetically.
Yes, right. But this is being filmed by Channel 11?
Phoenix Channel 11.
Right, and I watched them. I saw Sandra Day O'Connor on there. And we got to make it look like when they sweep back and forth like there's a crowd here. Could I get that last row back there to come up and sit in the front row? Make it look like there's a lot of people here. I really would appreciate it if you would. Yeah, please, Sue.
If not, we'll digitally morph you up.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah, if everybody would just move up. That way, too, it's a more intimate environment. Oh, thank you. Okay, you can start filming now. this looks pretty good. Right. Oh, God. Why did you write that?
You shouldn't have told me such good stuff.
And the business about humble. I always thought I was hot stuff, but I just kept quiet about it. I'm not humble. Oh, boy.
Even just as I go through, if you haven't read it, the table of contents gives you an insight into the kind of life the guy led. Chapter one, in which Billy is born and rides a yacht. He was known as Billy as a child. Chapter seven, in which Noss, his nickname in college, in which Noss pretends to be Catholic and boxes his way to Arizona.
Oh, yeah. Well, I couldn't have gone to the gym unless I was Catholic, or said I was. Yeah.
And boxing. Who knew that this man was a boxer? Pretty good one, too.
Well, no, it was a mistake. I lost more than I won, and But I had good excuses. One, I didn't train. The other was I ate a big meal before the fight. What was the third one? Oh, I was afraid of the other guys.
Chapter 10, in which Noss leaves college and sells fruit in Arizona.
Yeah, I had a little watermelon stand out at 36 in Indian School. I sold watermelons. That was my first job. And then I kept going to KPHO, and I'd walk in and try to sound like I knew what I was talking about doing a kid show. And then finally, I was begging on my knees. About the third or fourth time, they gave me a job.
Yeah, which is the next chapter, in which Wallace gets on TV and works at a bar, followed by chapter 13.
They didn't pay me very much. It was like $25 a show. So, of course, I went and got a job with Easy Deal Wilson out on Baseline as a bouncer and a bartender.
The guy from KPHO was here earlier. They still don't pay very much.
No, right.
He was envying your paycheck of $25 a week.
Right. Oh, you know, but after a while, I mean, you know, when I got up in the 60s, I think it was like 30, 35.
Chapter 13, in which Wallace gets a Ladmo.
Oh, you can only go so far by yourself with the one-man jokes. You need somebody else to bounce off. And Lad was a very funny cameraman, so I got him to come out. The first joke he ever did on the show?
Yeah.
It's good. He's looking around, he's backing into frame. And I said, what are you looking for? And he says, my Congressional Medal of Honor. And I said, where'd you lose it? And he says, out in the lobby. And I said, why are you looking in here? He says, the light's better in here. it's pretty good. Oh, and meeting up with that guy was really fortunate. He's such a great guy, perfect. The kids really liked him, and it clicked. And then about 5 years later, the demographics just exploded when we got McMahon on, because then we all of a sudden we had adults and college kids watching, and it was no longer just a kid show.
Yeah, chapter 17, in which Wallace and Gerald make children go crazy.
Oh, yes. I mean, over the line. They were after Gerald. He was hunted down, shot at. Some really scary stuff. And he deserved it.
There are times when, like, the people who don't know the show, and probably if you grew up on the show, one of your burdens is you have to try to explain the Wallace and Ladmo show to someone who has no idea. And one of the best descriptions is if you can tell them about Gerald. Because I don't think there's another kid show in America, I know there isn't, that had someone that children wanted to murder and that incited so much passion inside children to the point of blind rage.
Yeah, I can't tell you, I really can't, the stuff they would mail into them. You wouldn't believe it. You know? Some of them leaping out, spiders and things.
Oh, Pat McMahon did like 10 permanent characters, and each one of those personalities was a completely different person. They sounded different, they looked different. A guy could just morph into an old lady, and he was just great, and a hero, and a cowboy. Yes, he came from New Jersey, he had never been on a horse.
Marshall Good, yeah.
You're right, and the clown never... it didn't like kids. Captain Super had a nightlight. You see where we're going? The whole idea is it was a kid show with people with really serious problems. And that to us was very funny. I don't know what the audience thought, but we were having a good time. Yeah.
And chapter 32, in which Wallace gets placed in a museum. The Arizona Historical Society, when they opened up their new building, had a Hall of Fame. And they said, we got a place on the wall, and you can see it on in Tempe, just the other side of the north side of Rio Salado. We got a place on the wall, important Arizonans. And the first people they inaugurated, Barry Goldwater, Sandra Day O'Connor. I don't think they went alphabetically. Sandra Day O'Connor, Bill Keane, Greater Family Circus, and a guy in a derby, a guy in a top hat, and a guy wearing horn-rimmed glasses. Wallace being among the first inductees in the Arizona Historical Society. It only makes sense to us.
It was really nice. You know what they wanted me to do, though, I had to turn down the deal about actually being one of the artifacts. They had this exhibit with a chair, and I was supposed to sit there, and they'd come by and dust me off. And they got all the props, the films and tapes and all of that. So I could run there about once a week and just sit around and trip down memory lane.
It's too bad they still charge you admission, though. They shouldn't really do that.
I know.
He twisted my sense of humor. I realized that as I thought more as an adult about what he did. He twisted my sense of humor. He twisted probably all of your senses of humor with the characters he described. The mayor is a big fan, and the mayor is a little twisted. There are a lot of Arizona politicians. We like funny people. And I think if you're funny, John McCain is really funny. Jen Napolitano is really funny. The reason we sort of like funny people, I think, is because he warped us a little bit. Barry Goldwater was funny. Sandra Day O'Connor is funny.
Oh, Goldwater came down on the show and was going to sue LADMO because LADMO was threatening to build one of those LADMO drive-ins up on Camelback Mountain. It was great. So, you know, that was the whole deal about the routine. The bit was he came on the show to sue LADMO.
It's amazing that this guy who is Mr. Conservative, the father of modern conservatism, the inspiration for Ronald Reagan and the entire conservative movement, to me, was a guy who was on the Wallace and LADMO show. To imagine that Barry Goldwater agreed to appear not only just on the show to say hi, but that he agreed to appear in skits is just fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, we had a lot of politicians, a lot of athletes, it was one of the best things about the show. Imagine, I got to meet on the show Rocky Marciano, Joe Louis, Archie Moore, George Foreman. I'm leaving out one of the big heavyweights, but anyway. He was on three times. He got so carried away, he started whacking me around. It was great. We got good footage of it around. He's a really nice guy, too. I liked him a lot.
Yeah, and then the politicians, Goldwater, and then locally Paul Fannin.
Yeah.
Every governor had to come through.
And you'd think that they would hesitate to go on a kid's show that made fun of everything. And that was the whole idea. Everything's fair game. Anything for a laugh. The more bizarre or twisted, the better.
Which, yeah, it was kind of silly.
Right.
Maybe you should have been stopped.
Yes, we should have been stopped around 60, 61.
Which is the other thing I found out in researching is that every city did have a kid show, and around 1972, well, it's in the book, the FCC said that kid show hosts could no longer do commercials. That was curtains for every kid show in America, except for two of them, Bozo the Clown and the Wallace and LADMO show. The only people left who had an audience that didn't care, the station wasn't making money off of them selling Arrowhead water. Are we allowed to do this on Phoenix 11?
Sure.
That they were making money because people liked the show, watched the show, and were entertained by the show. Again, there's only two places left, WGN, Bozo, because of cable TV and the superstation, and here. We kept this show on the air and kept this guy with us.
And part of it was we didn't take anything seriously, including the commercials. I used to drop kick the scooter pies. The agency people would complain, but you know, they all seemed to renew. So, yeah. Hey, something I want to tell you is the strange procedure that goes on when an author and the guy he's writing about get together, and the trust and the bond. And I really enjoyed working on this with Richard, and I just trusted him completely, which I should note, because there's some stuff in here that I'm going to sue him over.
The autographed copy from your lawyer was very nice.
Yeah.
I appreciated it. It was served by, I mean, I hope you enjoyed it. I hope the story means a lot to you. But while he's here, I can stop getting information out of him. And you can. If you have any questions about the show or how the book was put together, we'd be glad to.
Yes.
Thanks for my Lenovo bag.
Oh, when did you get it? Well, you know, in Arizona, there's two groups. There's one that got Ladmo bags, and some people that didn't. And I'm always so delighted when they did get one, because then I find myself feeling sorry for the person that didn't and apologizing. But Lad tried. He gave away, over the years, over 8,000 or 9,000 of them.
This probably isn't the best time to bring this up, but I never won a Ladmo bag. You probably don't remember because you did so many, and why should I stick out as one of your audience members? Came with the Cub Scout troop. It was that show with the Cub Scout troop that was in the audience, if you remember that. 77. And I was going to sit down on a seat, but Aaron D. Lavara actually took the seat I was going to sit in. And you gave him the Ladmo back.
I'll tell you why. Because you put in that deal about me stealing the watermelon.
Oh, and for Phoenix Channel 11, who's taping this, they want us to repeat the audience people's audience members' questions, so the audience at home could hear. And they heard your answer, but they didn't hear what she said. She was asking his opinion of the withdrawal of Supreme Court candidate Harriet Myers. Him choosing not to answer that with the Ladmo bag thing was his own personal choice. Well, but it was you deflected that nicely.
Yeah, I liked her. I thought she would have been mediocre.
Yeah, writing this book, we went through a couple elections.
Yes.
Some we agreed on, some we weren't so sure about. But
liberal.
Right wing.
Crazy. But we meet on an awful lot of things.
Yeah.
You know, we come together on. Oh, I need another question. Yes.
Should I repeat it twice? Or?
Oh.
You say it. I'll say it with you simultaneously.
In Spanish?
Oh.
Si podemos. Well, I don't know if City of Phoenix, Prop 200, we cannot do a Spanish translation. So.
Why not?
As a question, if I
sure.
Can as a statement, when Lamo died, I know you had a lot of Hispanic people watching, you know, Mexican-American families, and we're large families. And when Lamo passed away, my mom took his picture and put a candle. And you know, it was rural, but it was very poignant, you know. And my mom goes, you know, every hour, I had six of us, but every hour, between 4 and 5 o'clock, I could take a nap because I knew that you were safe because you were watching Los Lamo. So,
your mom made a santo out of Ladmo, a little vigil out of Ladmo's picture.
And that's true though, because they knew that their kids were safe because they were being watched by our uncles.
Wow.
Yeah.
Is it true that Steven Spielberg, in one interview, said his greatest regret in life is not winning a Ladmo bag? I read that in an article.
Question is, did Spielberg say that one of his regrets was not winning a Ladmo bag?
I heard that too, and we should correct that immediately, because we'd like him to make a movie about this. We'll send that over.
It'll be light on the special effects, but yeah. But he was, I mean, it is true, and you've probably seen this clip, that 35th anniversary, Bill Rose was interviewing him for Raiders of the Lost Ark. Actually, this would have been the 30th because it was 84.
Yeah.
Interviewing him for Raiders of the Lost Ark, and he happens to offhandly mention how he grew up with Channel 5 and how he grew up watching Wallace and Ladmo. And Bill Rose mentioned to him that they were still on the air, and his eyes grew wide and his jaw dropped. They're still on.
No, they're still alive?
Which I haven't done my daily check. Let's make sure. Okay, he's good. Yeah. Question in the back, sir, yes.
Yeah, I got a question. With the growth of Phoenix out by Legend City, when you made your silent films out there that you used to see on your show, where were they filmed? Because I'm always trying to figure out in the background, where were they made?
Oh, he's asking about movies like Cannonball Junction and some of the black and white westerns. That where they were filmed, because the city started to grow in around these desert areas. Yeah,
a lot of those were shot before Legend City was there, out where the zoo was and on the property, which was then just desert before Legend City was built. Then, of course, we shot all kinds of films at Legend City, and incidentally, I kept my Legend City stock if anybody wants to buy it.
It's another great piece of Arizona history. Legend City, the amusement park that was selling dollar shares of stock certificates.
And when you got the stock, you signed a pledge that you would go down there and clean up the place when it needed to be cleaned.
Oh. You know,
they joined some kind of association, and they found themselves mowing the lawn.
An amusement park in Phoenix with the summertime. How could it not work?
I don't know. Right.
Questions out there?
Madam, please. We can't afford to lose one person.
Sit down in front.
We're so blessed that you came to us in Arizona. What brought you to Arizona in the first place?
I was born. Oh, he means you.
No. He's always been here. He was born here. Okay. I was born in a little village outside of New York City in Westchester County. And my cousin Ned, who's born here, he called and he says, hey, they're opening a TV station. And that was in 49, and in December of 49, KPHO went on the air, and he says, get out here and get on the ground floor. I had been down to New York City and gone to the TV station. There was no chance that they would take a guy with no experience. I could not get a job there in television, but I thought that was pretty near the very beginning of television, but I thought that was something that I would like to do, because I could put all of the things that I had learned into use. And so I came out, but it took like four or five times to going over to KPHO to finally get the job. And Emmett Lancaster, the artist, hired me as a assistant art director, and Claire Yares hired me to be on the studio crew, and I was the boom operator. It was like a fishing reel, you know, we'd go and pick up the people. They didn't mic them individually then. And that started, and then I struck up a friendship with Ken Kennedy, who was Goldust Charlie, and he asked me to come on, and I told him I'll come up with a bit every day, and so I did, and it was usually something getting broken and me getting blamed for it, and that cycle of destruction continued when Ladd came on the show, you know, but it was to come out here and get started. In a business I wanted to get into, but could not be done in New York City where I had worked, and I had jobs in New York City, like I worked for the American Heritage Foundation, and I was in the mailroom. And McGraw-Hill Publishing, I was the guy on the conveyor belt, you know, would put the books in the boxes. That's what's going on, you know, the boxes we shipped out to libraries and schools and stuff. By the way, you can get this book right here at this library. I mean, you can take it out.
What a salesman.
You don't have to buy one. You can just take it out.
Oh, that's true. It's on the shelf. I mean, you can, yeah.
But I think
what the library is here for, yeah.
Yeah, I think the proceeds of this helped the library.
And the library, yeah.
Yeah, it's a good cause.
It's a great cause. Yeah. You used to have fun with the boom mics on, with the people operating the boom mics on your own show, too.
Oh, yeah. What Ladd and I used to do, we'd separate. Now, the boom operator, what does he do? He's got two guys. Yes, and then we'd get wider and wider apart. You weren't supposed to do that. You're supposed to keep your people that were talking together in a group.
By the way, the version he told you about how he came here is pretty much the story he told everybody. At the Republic, I went through the archives, and I read pretty much every story they had on him, which are a lot. And really, all the writers of the Republic tried to outdo themselves in fawning praise for the show. It was a little embarrassing. But we've abandoned that policy now.
That was one of my first jobs here after the watermelon stand. I worked at the Phoenix Gazette.
Yeah.
And we all know what happened to them.
I filed the last story for the Phoenix Gazette.
Did you really?
Yes. But the stories he tells, again, were very quick. The story that's in here is a little more nuanced, which involves the idea that he had a fairly nice life set up for him. And if he chose to sort of do what everyone else did, go to college, get a degree in, I don't know, business or something, accounting.
Something smart.
Something smart.
Yeah.
He would have had a very nice life set up for him. And I mean a pretty nice life. And he gave that up because all his life he wrote skits, he drew cartoons, he wrote funny plays. He wanted to make people laugh. Yeah. And so we were lucky that Channel 5 opened up out here. And this was, again, this is why it's a great Arizona story. A guy can lift himself out of New York and come here and, you know, just come here to the desert and reinvent himself and, you know, start anew. And so he gave up a lot to come here, and I'm really glad he did. Yeah.
Oh.
Yes, yes, sir.
Would you tell the people about your coaching career at Bernie Park?
I can.
The coaching career at Bernie Park, the city of Phoenix. Right. You and the city of Phoenix are tied at the hip.
1954. The team was Hispanic, and they were good. And I was coaching, and they won. It was the record that year. We won 11-0.
Bernie Park was on the south part of town, right?
Right, and the players were young fellas like 15, 14, and 16, right in there. And they were good. I really had fun. Bernie Park, I assume that's still there. Is it? Oh my gosh, isn't that something? Yeah.
Did you work at Bernie Park? Did you know the Bernie Park?
He was in charge of the parks.
Oh, fantastic.
Parks director at Wells and Landrow, we had a program called You All Come Week, and they generously gave up their time, and for six consecutive nights, they appeared on the back of a semi-truck and put on their show.
Wow.
Right. Very generously, and I remember...
All through the park system. All through the park system, they put on their show on a stage.
This was the county at that time.
Oh,
that,
wow.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
And I think it was 12 parks, because that's how many teams it seemed like we played. Right.
And that really was the joy of the show, the idea that you watch these guys all week. And then that weekend, there they were at the park, there they were at the shopping center, there they were at Christown, Legend City, the State Fair. The State Fair every day.
Yeah.
Can you imagine the State Fair every day? Which is great. The State Fair would be great every day. Don't get me wrong. But that was the magic of the show here. This man had one hand up.
When and how did the idea of the Gold Dust Charlie show start?
Gold?
He's asking about the Goldust Charlie show and how you...
You know, I hear that today, how I took Goldust Charlie's show away. Honest, I didn't.
No, I'm not saying.
Oh. Goldust Charlie, he went on in 51. He was on 51, 52, 53, 54. It was almost 5 years. It's just in about his second or third year, he had me come on, but he had other people on too. And it's just... I got what they call a spinoff, where they bought some cartoons that didn't fit on Ken's format, so they created something for me at 6:30 between the news and whatever the 7 o'clock syndicated shows were. I don't, at that time it was just KPHO, like in early 54, late 53. There was NBC, came later, CBS came later, ABC came later. The other network was Dumont with Rocky King Detective, Boston Blackie. Yeah, I don't know if anybody here remembers the Dumont network. I saw a yawn, I better knock it off. Yes?
Tell us about the bruising ratings battle that you had with Lou King.
Oh. The ratings battle with Lou King's Rangers.
Well, no, actually, his was a different kind of show on at a different time. We had a very good relationship with Lou. We'd appear on his show, and we'd have him on our show. And he was a nice guy, and he helped a lot of people get their career started.
He was also on Channel 5, right? So there
yeah,
was
he was on Channel 5. This is before he went over to Cool at TV. But I suppose his ratings are just fine. Ours held up good. We were sold out. And,
you know. Well, the ratings battle, you mentioned that, again, going through the archives of all the newspapers to look at the TV schedules. And every station had a show. There was Trapper Jim, the Big Ten Ranch Gang. Everyone had one until he came on in April of 54. And by December of 54, they were all gone. And and it just, I mean, shows how unique his show was. Even with just him by himself doing one-man bits,
well,
he was pretty much, I mean, for a little while, those first few months.
Yeah, ours was the only show where things got destroyed. The cowboy guys, you know, they did a lot of roping and all that. But they were fine. They're good shows.
But
yes,
no one,
sir.
Yeah.
My sister used to have to bribe me so she could watch the American Bandstand.
Oh, yes.
But I was wondering, how old are you?
I'll be 74 in about a month.
Oh,
and I'm just... Maybe. Yes.
Yes, I have a question. How did you acquire your hat, and how many hats did you guys destroy through the show? Because everybody from Mr. Grudgemeyer to Ladno always got their hats destroyed.
Yeah.
Asking about hats.
Right. And hats did play a big part in the show. We had a deal with Bert Easley. If one little chip was off one of those straw hats, it went in a box to go to us. So at the end of the month, we'd swing by and pick up usually a box this high, just full. So of course, Ladmo and Grudgemeyer would have one of their deals where Grudgemeyer was selling the hats and they'd all get destroyed. My first hat was a little, it looked like a yarmulke, you know, like, it really did, it was a little beanie. And then after that, I wore a straw hat. Then I finally settled on the Derby, and Ladmo had the top hat right all the way straight through the whole 36 years. Yes.
Yeah.
All right.
But
well, that's it. Thanks a lot.
Oh. You ever see Pat?
Every once in a while. I'm out in the same part of town, but I live kind of down like this, and he's way up on... on Squaw Peak, and I don't see him too often, and I'm on the C list.
The C list for McMahon.
Yeah, if you're on the A list, you get invited to his Christmas party. If you're on the B list, you get a Christmas card, and if you're on the C list, nothing. Right. You're all on the C list, I guess. Me too.
There would be no Pat without Wallace.
That's right. That's right. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm supposed to be humble. I thought you said that the other way around.
Good thing she wasn't mic'd.
Pat was so important to the show, and he's really a very nice guy, a very generous guy. It's just he and I just always tease the hell out of each other.
the other night. He's very, very concerned about his age because he's still on the air. So the other night at the Emmy cast, we both come out. We're presenters, you know, and the local Emmys. And I told him, I said, you know, Pat, Ladd and I always looked up to you, and not just because you were the oldest. And McMahon jumps in, no, shortest. Yeah.
Question from the library staff member.
Patty Lionel's tie-off. Now, this was before they went to the printed t-shirt. When did that start? Whose idea was that?
Cutting Lionel's tie-off.
He hands to the bowler, and then the tie would get cut off.
Yeah, that was part of the Grudgemeyer Ladmo business. Yeah, cutting those. Because there was an huge supply of those long ties. We could get them from Bertie's. And then the kids started sending them. And they had contests. So we had like a huge box of hundreds of those. So Ladmo had an awful lot of ties cut right off. And years later, I saw Letterman do that to one of his guests. He did clip and then, nice tie, bonehead.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you ever take vacation? And how did you keep going on that hectic schedule day in, day out, and the weekends?
Well, yeah, it was 7 days a week because I loved it.
I never did take a vacation. I didn't want to. Mainly it was like running a small town newspaper or something. Boy, you had to be on top of it every day, all the details. And I couldn't really leave it to other people because they came in as outside talent. So I had everything ready for them. And I never really wanted to take a vacation. And I finally worked out a deal where they would pay me extra that I didn't, you know, how do you explain that?
Like you got paid for the vacation time you didn't take.
Right, in addition to the regular salary. And that was just fine. I was doing what I liked. I wouldn't have wanted to be anywhere else.
The day you were married to Katie, you didn't take a day off.
No, that's right. No, Katie, stand up and wave.
Get a crowd around you first.
Right. Yeah. And the day we got married, this is worth telling. Which, no, that too. But Orson Welles had seen Captain Super on television, and he says, I want that Captain Super guy. I want him to play a part in a movie I'm making out in Paradise Valley. So they told McMahon, he didn't believe him, and they told him to meet him under a bridge in Tempe. This big car pulled up, and Orson Welles got out. And McMahon was just flat. He thought that we were playing one of our tricks. Now, I'm not going to go down that lane. Well, I can later. But yeah. So anyway, Orson Welles says, we're filming tonight. Come out and bring your fat friend and your skinny friend. So Katie and I, we got married at lunchtime. Ladmo was the best man. But that night after, that evening after we finished the TV show, we went out to Paradise Valley. And he's there, and there are hundreds of people making this movie called West of the Wind, or Wind of the West.
The Sound of the Wind. It never came out. Yeah, something like that.
It never came out. It was one of those deals where they get a lot of people to invest, and then they try to reach Orson in Switzerland or something. But anyway, Orson Welles stops everything in the scene where reporters were crowding around, and he says, Katie and Bill have decided to spend their wedding night with us. It was great. And John Huston's going. It's great. Oh, geez.
With the practical joke thing, there is another practical joke story worth telling, which is the Beatles practical joke story on McMahon, which is fantastic.
Oh, yeah. You know, if he ever came back, the second coming I'm talking about, that was what it was like to McMahon, to just meet a Beatle. So when the Beatles planned their trip to Los Angeles, I wrote a letter to Apple.
Yeah, Brian Epstein, the manager.
Right. And I said, please stop in Phoenix. We would love to have you come to Sun Devil Stadium and put on a concert. And then I had my friend in the art department, Pete Kirsten, dummy up a letter. All I wanted back from them was the No Chance in Hell letter that they sent. But I had the envelope. And the envelope, you know, it was Beatles stationery and it's London, you know, and the British stamps and everything. And Pete Kirsten copied the exact kind of stationery that would go in there, the right color and everything. And in there, it said, we can make it. We need $25,000 up front. And we need an opening act. And I showed it to McMahon, and he was... One, I'll mortgage my house. Two, Hubcap. He said, Hubcap will be the opening act. He says, I'll get the 25. And so Pat started planning the press parties, the buffet. He was planning down to what the hors d'oeuvres would be, which reporters were coming and which ones weren't. To the press party, depending on how good reviews that we had gotten. And then right in the middle of one of these things where he was planning the menu or something or what award that, something that he was going to get for bringing the Beatles to town, you know, something like that. Lamo just burst out laughing. And Lamo, when he laughs, something like that, he's also crying. And he's the Jewish time, he just slid down the wall, and McMahon looked at him and realized that we had been spent 2 weeks setting him up for this. He threw an ashtray at me. And he went on and kicked my mouth. That's great.
So it wasn't just the demented sense of humor on the show.
Yes.
This was ingrained deep inside you.
We spent a lot of time pulling tricks on McMahon. You know, you go right for the throat, you find out what is it this guy would really want, you know, and do it. So the Meredith people, they owned other TV stations, and they wanted to have a kids show that they could syndicate to all the stations, and you know, we were going to be included, but we told Pat that the budget said only Wallace and Lamo. They couldn't have we couldn't have any of Pat's characters on, and we said, so we've already done the pilot because we knew it would upset you. We at least want you to see what the pilot looks like that we're going to send to these other stations. And Lamo's standing there, he's got the Gerald hand puppet. By this time, McMahon is standing up, and it's in the conference room, and he's just leaning on the table looking like this. And Gerald, he's got the puppet, and, you know, Mr. Wallace, it's Lamo doing all this stuff. You know, he's doing the whole Gerald bit, you know. That time it was an attempt to throw a chair, but he couldn't get it up over the conference table. Jeez. Then from then on he never believed anything. And it was after that the Orson Welles thing came up, and he did not believe that Orson Welles was going to meet him under a bridge in Tempe. And he said, I was down there, I was looking up, waiting to see Ladd and I up there at the top of the ridge laughing.
The Other Side of the Wind, that's the name of that Orson Welles movie, and there's actually a documentary where they talk about why it was never completed one of his last projects, and there is a clip where you can see McMahon in that wedding scene, which is very nice.
Yeah, yeah, he was a reporter.
Yeah.
Following him around, you could hear him yelling at Orson Welles. Yeah, that was good.
For those, I mean, growing up here, I always had like a slight, maybe it was just the times, an Arizona inferiority complex. Phoenix wasn't a great city. We don't have a lot of history. It's other people's place, and we're just kind of here. And the census numbers now show that half of people who live in Arizona are from Arizona, are actual native Arizonans. Hope that number increases. And we do have history. We do have stuff that was unique and special that could only happen here. And I'm glad you guys were able to come out and celebrate with us tonight.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you very much. Okay. What do we do now? Thank you very much.
You've been watching the Authors and Poets series taped at Burton Barr Central Library. For replay information on this program, call Phoenix 11 at 602-261-8937 or check online at phoenix.gov/11.